I'm Peter Michael. I'm the Managing Director of Michael's Camera, Video and Digital Melbourne. It's my great pleasure to introduce Warwick from Fujifilm Australia, who's the International Product Specialist.
Thank you very much, Peter, for that introduction. Of course, I'm John Workington from the Michael's Camera social media team. And as Peter said, we've got Warwick Williams with us here from Fujifilm Australia. And he is a product specialist.
Yeah, the national digital specialist.
Digital specialist.
Just because I've done some stuff overseas.
And of course,
sounds reasonable.
We're also joined by one of our in-house experts, Paul Daniels. Hi. And he's got a vast amount of experience in all things photographic. As well, he brings an awful lot of medium format expertise to the table. And of course, this is a new area for me. And I can honestly tell you, I've played with one medium format camera. And this is it, the brand new Fuji GFX 50s. And with very little trouble, I had this thing in my hand and I was shooting pictures with it probably within five minutes. And wow. I think that's really important for people to know. So I want to obviously thank Warwick for joining us today. We're here, it's Saturday morning at Michael's Camera. We're in the world famous camera museum. And Warwick's here to help our customers out with a hands-on demo day with the GFX 50S.
Yep.
And so we've got a collection of cameras on the table here. But I'm just going to hand it over to Warwick and tell us, where do you see this product sitting in Fuji's line and in customers' hands? What's getting people excited about this?
Well, I guess it's going to assume flagship status, being the best, I suppose, camera that can produce the best photo quality. No disrespect, sorry, X series. But, yeah, no substitute for cubic inches, as they say in the car industry. And sensor size on here is just so big. The medium format sensor produces the best picture quality. It's got the best detail, and as I've discovered, the best micro transition definition. Now, if you're wondering what that is, go and shoot some photos of snow. Hmm. And if you can, shoot it with even an X series or a full frame, and then shoot it with a medium format, and you'll suddenly see more detail than you've ever seen in your life. It's a bit of a drug in that sense. Once you've actually done that, it's very hard to go back to anything else. So the one thing I will say about this, though, that this really, even at the price, does put medium format in the reach of a lot more people. It really does. So your enthusiasts as well as your professionals.
And that's very important to bring up. Obviously, everybody's price conscious in this day and age. But if you just step back 10, 15 years in the early days of full-frame 35mm format digital cameras and take a look at, you know, time value of money, this camera's the exact same price as those cameras were when they were introduced, if not cheaper.
Well, you're absolutely actually correct. Much cheaper, because initially, any professional full-frame camera, you were talking about $20,000 at least.
And the S1 Pro, when it came out, our first professional digital SLR, was the shockingly low price of $15,999.
So
it sold.
Yeah.
And that was back in, what, 1999, 2000?
It was actually very popular.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So we're sort of spoiled for choice with all these sub-$1,000 cameras, and some of them are spectacularly good. We just have to sort of have a bit of a reality check and realize how much value for money there really is in this camera. Now, the other thing you talked about is, you know, the halo status. You know, this is sitting at the top of the Fuji line. And it's a very interesting, you've stepped past full frame.
Yeah.
Why bother? You just went from what were brilliant X-Tran, APS-C style sensor cameras, skipped full frame altogether, and went to medium format.
Well, the reason for that is the whole concept of the X-Series camera was to give you full frame picture quality without the size and the weight. Mm. And the only way we could do that was to create a smaller camera and a smaller lens system. And the only way we could claim a full frame type of picture quality was to create a new type of sensor in effect. And so the X-Trans sensor was specifically designed to give that higher resolution output that you would normally get from an APS-C, something that would compete, and ultimately would, I believe, the X-Pro 2 and the X-T2 surpass full-frame sensors. So to me, it seemed only natural if we were going to go bigger, then we were going to go to a medium-format sensor. Mm. So there would be no point if we can do what a full-frame does with these, then really the logical next step would be to medium-format.
And of course, the DNA in these cameras is right here.
Absolutely.
So if we just take a look at the top panel, we've got the physical controls. And if you're familiar with the Fuji X series cameras, you're going to be right at home.
Yeah. Yeah.
And even if you're not, manual is, like, you don't even need to read the manual to put this camera into manual mode. It's just everything's at your fingertips. Yeah.
And the nice part is it's customizable. There's, sorry, X users, I know there's a few features that have appeared on here that you've been wanting on X cameras, but we're working on that. One of the really cool things, I think, is the, of course, everyone loves the aperture ring. Well, nearly everyone. For those that don't, there are actually now, is a lock-in C setting that transfers
cool
control of the aperture to your front command dial. And of course, if you then take your shutter speed dial, set that to T, that transfers control of your shutter speed to your rear command dial. So, if you prefer to use it that way, you can. If you prefer to use it the, dare I say, the old-fashioned way, you can do so as well. So, with that, with all the programmable or user programmable buttons on the back and things like that, it's very easy to customize it specifically to the way you want to use it. But otherwise, I always like to, when I pick these things up, use them without reading the manual. And I suppose in this sense, that was a little bit easy because I already knew how to use the X series. If you can use the X series, you can use this. But I know from experience, having taken this around to people who are not familiar with the X series, they don't have a whole lot of trouble. Oh, it's pretty obvious, shutter speed, ISO, aperture.
Yeah.
If you use a camera, you can use this.
And I'm proof positive, I did it.
Yeah.
There's no issue whatsoever. If you, for example, haven't used a Canon digital SLR ever, and maybe all you ever shot was with pictures on your iPhone, you picked up a Canon 5D, whatever, you might struggle to get to take a picture.
Yeah.
You know, as much as, you know, I'm so familiar with it because I shoot on those, I mean, it's only due to familiarity that I'm able to use the thing in my sleep.
Yeah.
And but this is just, it's just there, you know, it just works. One of the other things which is really important when you pick up a new camera is how does it feel in your hand? And there's no doubt in my mind that the Fuji cameras, these X series and the new GFX, they just have that feel of quality. Quality that, honestly, beyond the price point, I feel.
Yeah.
When you move these aperture rings, it just, you just know that someone was doing their work back in the R&D lab, and they've done it so well. There's a lot of expensive products that I use that when you, you know, adjust the controls, they're not feeling as good as they really should, considering the price you paid for them. I must admit,
definitive click movements on the lenses are very nice to use.
It's just beautiful. Tell us a little bit about where we're seeing, you know, the end users of this camera. Who's excited about it?
Well, as I've discovered from personal experience over the last few months, taking this out, testing it, and doing various consultations with pro photographers and such like, what has really surprised me is we have the full-time pro photographer is very excited about this. But also, your high-end enthusiast, your club photographer, and that sort of person is also very excited about it. For a pro, you're looking at a product here that is very easy to use, very well balanced, has all the features you're looking for. It's faster, it's better picture quality, and it's lower cost than probably what they're using at the moment. And so what's the reason you wouldn't buy it? It's come out with three lenses. So we've got the 63, and we've got the 64, or 32 to 64, and of course the 120 macro. It's a 1-2 macro with image stabilization. We've got another three on the way, which is the 110 f2, and there's the 23 and the 45 coming as well. If that wasn't enough, there's also an adapter that allows you to use the Hassel, I'm not allowed to say that H word, am I? the HC lenses. Well, after all, they were made by Fujinon in Japan. So the Fujinon HC lenses that also have that H definition there, you can put those lenses on here. That adds another 9 lenses to the range straight away. So it's a working system immediately.
Now, if I can just interject, for those who aren't familiar with the how things change with sensor size, because this sensor is larger than a full-frame 35mm sensor, and also it's a slightly different shape. It's a 3-4 aspect ratio versus the 3-2 aspect ratio that many 35mm photographers are familiar with. And, of course, there you can see it inside the mount. It's very large. So a 63mm lens on this format is basically your normal lens.
That would be 50mm
equivalent.
Yep.
So that's just sort of remember. The crop factor, I think, is 0.79. Mm.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So crop factor, yeah, going finally.
Your full frame,
is a crop sensor. Exactly.
So you've basically got like a 25 to 50 in the zoom. You've got a 50 prime, and you've got what? There was like a 95.
That's a 95.
Now this one is image stabilized.
Yes.
What are the long image stabilization in the line? And we're going to see more image stabilized lenses.
I believe so. Look, there are more lenses. Some of them I'm not at liberty to talk about, but there's certainly, we've got, as I said, another three planned before the end of the year. They're set in concrete, but there are others next year. I believe there's another zoom, and there's some other products as well. I don't know. I Fujifilm do try and be a little bit fluid as to what we're doing, what's under demand at the time. We respond very much to feedback from customers. I already know that there's a firmware upgrade being planned based on feedback. It's actually rather nice, is that having taken this around in the last month to New Zealand, around Australia, no criticism. We're just getting suggestions. It'd be nice if and so there will be a lot of that incorporated.
Well, you're famous for that, though.
Yeah.
Continually improving the camera with firmware upgrades. Mm. People really like that, I think.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. So there's been so many reports about, you know, the older models, new life comes into them with these firmware updates. So that's great. Yeah. I just think that the fact that we've got an image stabilized lens in a medium format system, I mean, I don't believe that's ever been done.
And this image stabilizer is highly effective.
Yeah.
We
use the linear motor system in there. Developed by us, so very fast, very accurate, and very quiet, and that's used in this lens for focus and for your image stabilization.
Well, I was shooting the lens recently because we had training in Japan, and I shot that at 60th, at 5.6, from a distance. I was shooting a model from about 4 meters away, and I had no trouble at all with the stabilization. Seeing afterwards the level of detail, I could see the pores in the skin.
Yeah.
Even though that's, I think I was using about 1600 ISO. But the ISO seems almost irrelevant. The quality of the image is still retained, even at higher speeds.
You know, what's interesting about that, an exercise we did was, we had a photo of a lady, beautiful skin complexion, and the photo was actually printed full size. If you look at the image, it's just wonderful. Mm. If you then walk up very close to it and start to look, you can see, as you pointed out, pores and pimples and hairs and things like that, and not so complimentary. The interesting part is, when I mentioned that micro-transitions, this is what it's all about. We actually took that photo and gave it to someone who's very good with Photoshop to clean it up, and they took out all those little bits and bumps and perhaps non-complimentary things, until we had it on a screen and all of us there agreed that, yes, that's an improvement. That picture looks much better. So then we printed it and stuck it next to the original, and it looked flat and drab.
Yes.
Those little bits and bumps and things are almost, that's the subconscious data your brain needs, or the micro-transition data your brain needs to interpret photoreality in almost 3D.
Yes. Yes.
Take that out. It might look great on a screen, but on a real print, you actually lose that photoreality. Now, this camera can deliver that. So, you know, you might say, I don't want to see all the little lines and things like that, but you know, it's what goes to deliver that photoreality to the human eye. This, I haven't seen that before in another camera.
Well, that's very interesting. How large have you printed files from the camera?
Well, we've done various prints, I think up to about 2 meters by 3 meters.
And quite large.
The camera itself can shoot in compressed RAW and uncompressed RAW, and interestingly enough, can also process those files in camera, and that's actually when we were doing these prints, this is how we were doing it. You can process them into 8-bit TIFFs or a high quality JPEG. So aside from the JPEGs that it can create anyway. What we're finding out now, of course, with people now processing files through Lightroom, they're getting staggering amounts of detail out of it, and even the most finicky customers are saying it's the best detail they've ever seen out of a RAW file.
I was blown away by the JPEGs I was getting.
Yeah.
And a week after I started shooting with the camera, Lightroom supported the RAW files, and then when I started processing those RAW files, it was like another camera was born.
Yeah.
There was just so much more detail available, and there was nothing wrong with the JPEGs.
Yeah. I know, I had just a couple of days ago a photographer send me a picture on my iPhone, which had been downgraded to 3 megapixels by that stage, and he was saying he'd taken a photo of a subject and then said, you've got to see the detail in this. So he cropped the picture and then sent me this cropped version to my iPhone. I zoomed up on my iPhone, and you could see the veins in this guy's eye. You could actually see the reflection of what was in the studio in his iris. I mean, it's just on an iPhone. It's just crazy.
Well, we were joking when we were looking at the files. We were, you know, doing the old CSI thing in hands.
Yeah.
Because the zoomability is just is just staggering.
Yeah.
And I mean, I'm addicted to resolution, so this is why it's a really exciting camera for me. Now, I want to talk to you a little bit about artificial lighting in the camera. Have you done some work with studio strobes or with the Fuji flash system on it?
We did in when I was doing my training in Japan. Yes, we had it all connected up in a studio over there. We were using strobes. Sorry, I don't know exactly which ones
Doesn't matter.
But
I'm sure they'd all work.
The reason they did this is because they actually chose a guy who was a professional photographer. He actually did models and items for sale.
Product photography.
Product photography. That's it. He just basically replaced the camera he was using with this, plugged in. Our techs made a few adjustments so he could actually throw his files into the software he was using, and it just worked. So we had a plenty of time to play around, even doing multiple frames and multiple exposures, and playing around on this camera in a lot of ways that he couldn't with what he was currently using. It was just no problem at all. Just
no limitations. No.
You can, of course, use the EFX 500 flash on here, just the same way as you've used it on the X series cameras. So you can use it in up to 3 groups and control those groups from a flash on the camera. One thing I was actually playing around with at home the other week was actually with the macro lens and putting the flash on the eyepiece and tilting the flash down.
Oh, that's actually, yeah, I never even thought about that. Yeah,
so never even go to it.
No rules,
right? Yeah, you do.
Whatever
very
works.
Interesting.
So,
now, one thing I wanted to bring up, and just more of, just to tell the users a little bit, there's been a lot of talk about sync speed with this camera. And I think there's a little bit of a misunderstanding of what sync speed means. People are getting hung up that, oh, the camera's only got a sync speed of 125th of a second.
Yeah.
But what you've got to remember is that the flashes are what stop time in studio photography.
You do have high-speed sync using our system.
Well, that's true.
The GFX 500. And I would imagine, as I know some of the other flashes are compatible with high-speed sync on our X series, I can't see any reason it's the same thing why they wouldn't work high-speed on here.
Oh, no. I mean, the Pro Photo system, which actually was what that guy was using, would work perfectly in this situation.
And also, the lens, the camera is and was specifically designed as well, not just to be a focal plane shutter camera, but also to offer compatibility with leaf shutter lenses.
So that
gives you a shutter sync speed of 800th of a second.
Yeah, which is beyond what most digital SLRs are anyway. Most of them are only like 200th or 250th. So the sync speed sort of matters if you're trying to cut out ambient light from your flash photos, but indoors, there's no way the ambient light's going to be at any level where it's even
a factor.
But if you're trying to kill the sunlight, well, that's where it can come into play. But there's an awful lot of solutions for that. So I think it's a bit of a storm in a teacup. So I think we've covered that issue. Now, one of the most important things. Now, we didn't bring out a digital SLR from one of the competing manufacturers or whatever, but suffice it to say, yesterday's video, it's the exact same size. It's the cameras most people are using now, and they carry those all day. As a matter of fact, in some of the cases, I think with the Nikon and the 24 to 70 I had out here, I think it weighs less. Because that new 24 to 70 Nikon is a heavy lens.
I was in a lift the other day up in Brisbane, and a guy said to me, oh, is that a full frame? And I said, well, it actually makes your full frame a crop sensor. I took the lens off and showed him the sensor. He went,
that'd be
I can't repeat what
point.
He actually said at that point.
Because you're going to be showing that sensor off to everybody. You might want to learn to clean it. Because you've got to show that.
Yeah.
You might need a T-shirt with a picture of it.
That's an interesting concept. Bit of marketing there.
Yeah.
If there is a dirty sensor, it's going to be that one. This is my poor old pre-production one, which I'm desperately trying to hang on to rather than sending it back to Japan. I grow attached to these things, and
I'll just forget about it.
I've put this through the works. You know, right there. You know, one of the what I'm known for is pushing the cameras to their limits. When I did the test of the X-T2 and they said it was weather resistant, people said how weather resistant. So I whacked a 16mm lens on it and took it out into monsoonal rains on the Navua River in Fiji on a canoe and was letting waves wash over it and stuck it under a waterfall. And that camera, by the way, works to this day.
So we can expect the same.
So I can't see any reason why not. I've already got this certainly well and truly wet, and it's courtesy of the New Zealand weather on Waiheke Island. You know, the day starts out nice and sunny, so this is how you're dressed. Mm. Next thing you know, it feels like the middle of winter and there's a driving rainstorm. And that was kept for an hour and a half in driving rain amongst myself and about nine other photographers at that stage. Just as you see here, this very camera, no problem at all.
That has to be a first. I can't imagine any of the competing medium format cameras.
I'm not aware of something where everything is weather resistant. Yeah. So whether using the adapter, the tilt adapter for the eyepiece, anything, it's a complete weather resistant system.
I do sell other things that begin with other letters that claim weather resistance. To a certain degree. But one thing I was noticing about this, seeing you've used it fairly hardly, you're saying, is it really doesn't show any signs of wear.
No. And this has been into the outback. It's been over to New Zealand in wind and rain, very heavy wind and rain. I haven't actually had it in snow. We've taken photos of snow and ice in a studio.
But the operating temperature is quite low as well, isn't it?
Yeah, so the typical, the usual thing, minus 10 and up to half. I'm actually going to take it, hopefully, to Dubai in a few weeks. We'll test it out there. I know it's 32 at the moment, I think.
Just pop the battery out so we can show people. It's got a very beefy battery, great battery life.
Yeah, so probably better if I actually take the one out of this one. That's my pre-production battery. This one's got all the letters and numbers on it, but the same thing. Yeah, so it is bigger than the MPW 126S that's in the X series batteries. But you get about 400 shots out of that. And of course, with the grip on, you put a second one in, that's about 800 shots. And if you actually put the camera into an economy mode, you can stretch it out to about 900 shots for the two batteries. And that does seem to bear fruit. You know,
what does that limit, putting it into economy mode?
It slows things down, so you'll notice the refresh rate in the viewfinder is probably a little bit slower. Oddly enough, what we call economy mode is still faster than any other manual format.
Yes.
It's eminently usable in a lot more applications than you would normally expect a medium format camera to be used.
I just wanted to relate a couple of my user experiences with it. I've just found, again, right out of the box, it was easy to use, feels great in the hand. I'm extremely impressed with the autofocus capabilities of it. Again, there's, you know, like all the couch complainers are always, oh, it's not fast as long as it. The thing is rock solid. Did everything I expected it to do. I had no problems at all, and there's so many focus points. The other thing I was extremely impressed with was the accuracy of the exposures. So when I put it into aperture priority mode, I was never riding exposure compensation. I mean, this thing is just right on the money delivering what I need. And then, of course, the shadow detail that's available to push later on in highlight recovery, whereas I'm used to always riding exposure compensation.
You've got to remember, Fujifilm, you know, in terms of cameras, I know we've been in film and color a long time. Medium format is where we've been since we started making cameras. And that went right through, even in 1968 when we launched the G690, which is sort of the first compact medium format, if we call it that. But we've been medium format up until about 2014 when we started retooling to make this baby. But there's a lot of medium format cameras out there that Fujifilm have produced over the years, and so that adds up to a lot of experience in this area.
Now, one question I was wondering about, now that we've got the new G mount, will Fuji open up the communications protocol so that third-party vendors can make lenses?
Now that's something I can't comment on. I don't know.
Because we've seen some adapters come out, some dumb adapters.
Yes, certainly.
So, you know, I'm sort of wondering if the Metabones people of the world will be able to make some smart adapters.
I'm sure Metabones would certainly be very interested in doing it. out of curiosity, yeah, I'm happy to see that.
I've seen a few people announce various devices.
Yeah.
So even with AF capability.
Yeah.
Because when we think about what's happened with mirrorless cameras and all the legacy glass that's found new love and new life on these cameras, and we know that the Sony full-frame mirrorless cameras, I mean, people are mounting anything. You know, ancient Russian lenses are going on these things.
Yeah.
We've got the ability with focus assist aids here to manually focus anything reliably. The distance from the mount to the sensor is not that great, so basically anything is mounted further out.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of glass that could find new life here.
Yeah, it's like, I mean, I have a fairly sizable camera collection myself, and it's, you know, it's like driving an old car. You don't take your old car out because you want power steering and power windows and that. And so the different lenses add different textures and different look and feel, different characteristics to your photos. So as I said earlier, really there's no rules. So do what you must. Yeah, it would make for a more interesting experience.
Yeah.
Whether it's going to happen, I don't know. Personally, I'd like to see it, but I also would like to see a lot more Fujinon lenses as well.
Yeah. Well, you certainly got a nice package of three to start with. Mm-hmm. So a working pro can buy exactly what we've got on the table here and get to work.
Yeah, well, you probably, even rec retail, you probably have 12,000 for that, probably around 17,000 for this with extra batteries, the grip, and the tilt adapter, which, by the way, I should point out, one of the most common questions I get, people think there are multiple viewfinders. Mm. Not at the moment. There is actually the standard viewfinder that comes in the body kit, and then there is the actual adapter. So, and that adapter allows you to tilt and swivel the viewfinder, and that goes between the viewfinder and the body, and as we have here. So you don't lose the flash mounting capability. In fact, you can, and I've tried it, you can even mount the flash on the adapter without putting the EPF on there for whatever reason you want to do that.
Yeah, so there's an awful lot of ways that you can use the camera. And of course, it's a mirrorless camera. You can just use it with the rear LCD like you're
playing. Well, that's the fun. The first time I ever saw this camera, because we didn't have the advantage of having the viewfinder then, that's it. And it just felt strangely familiar, just holding it with that lens, just like that. The screen popped out, and just looking down, and I thought,
and actually using it that way.
It just felt normal.
Yeah. Using it that way with the tilt adapter and putting the flash on there with a macro.
Yeah.
Would be quite a viable system.
Yes, and I've seen many people do that, and they love it. So there's obviously a lot of experience from our guys in Japan that has gone to produce this product, and not all of it may seem obvious, but when you use it, it suddenly becomes quite clear.
There's some quite imaginative people have gone into designing this, haven't they?
Yeah. What I really love about working with Fujifilm and the privilege of going over to Japan and working with the guys over there is there are some people that have unbelievable amounts of knowledge, and they've been with the company a long time. But we don't turn away from young people, and the guys that are in there that have developed a lot of the new stuff, the new sensors and things like that, you would be surprised at their age. You know, we're talking 20s, mid-20s, and these guys are so accomplished and so clever. It's a joy to work with the company, and it's a joy, of course, to have these sorts of products coming out as well.
Wow, well, that's an amazing roundup, and I think what we better do is call it a day, because Warwick's got to get downstairs and start doing some hands-on demonstrations with this,
and
Paul and I will try to help out where we can.
Sure.
And we really want to thank you for joining us here in our world-famous camera museum, and to show us this exciting new product
which you've got. Yeah, if you haven't been here, you've got to have a look. Yeah, it's worthwhile. It's always changing. I come here a lot, and always got to come up here and have a look.
So again, we want to thank you for joining us in our little sort of casual roundtable discussion with Paul, Warwick, and myself. And stay tuned for more exciting reviews and usage reports or whatever with the Fuji GFX 50s. We're all excited about it, and we're hoping to get a few more in inventory in the coming days,
so that
more of the employees here at Michaels can have a chance to take one home and get some shots. And maybe within a very short period of time, we can start to see some of the work printed on the walls here at Michaels. We haven't had a chance to really wander too far away from the store with the camera right now, but coming soon. I've had a chance to play with it up on the roof a little bit, but I've only got about four different subjects I can shoot from the roof, a few building tops. But we've certainly enjoyed using the camera, and we're very, very pleased to have Warwick here with us today to get our customers a chance to have a bit of hands-on time with the new GFX. So we'll see you on the next video. Take care.
Thank you. Always good to be at Michael's.
Thank you.